The History of John Crane. October 2007 compiled by John Herschel. John Francis Crane was born on 11 September 1915. Crane served an apprenticeship and qualified as a machinist in 1942. In 1950, Crane was working for the Consolidated Aircraft Corporation Conair in San Diego. Crane met Rife when Crane was trying to buy a very high-quality drafting set from Rife. During their discussions, Rife told Crane about the microscopes that he had built and about the Rife Ray instrument and that the device had been used to cure cancer and other illnesses. During that same year, John Marsh became Crane's supervisor at Conair when Marsh moved from Tucson, Arizona to San Diego, California. Marsh's wife had developed cancer of the uterus and the doctors in Tucson recommended that she be taken to San Diego for specialist treatment. Marsh told Crane about his wife's illness and so Crane took Marsh to meet Rife. Apparently Rife was initially reluctant to get involved, but Marsh pleaded with Rife for his assistance to help cure his wife's illness. Eventually Rife agreed to help and he gave Marsh an old broken beam ray instrument that had been stored away in the basement of his house. Rife told Marsh that Vern Thompson, who was working with the San Diego Police Department as a radio engineer, had previously done some electronic work for him. In fact, Thompson had worked on Dr. Yale's beam ray instruments and apparently knew those instruments inside and out. Marsh asked Thompson to repair the instrument that Rife gave them. Marsh then treated his wife with the instrument and after several treatments Marsh said that his wife's pain had disappeared and that she got well. Marsh and Crane were so impressed with the miraculous results achieved with the frequency instrument that they decided to persuade Rife to work with them to build frequency instruments and get them into doctors' hands to help people who were suffering from incurable diseases. Crane then set up a company called Allied Industries to develop and construct Rife frequency instruments. Rife and Marsh were partners in the company. Rife provided the technical and scientific expertise, while it appears that Marsh handled sales and marketing. Crane then hired Thompson as their electronics engineer. Although much of Rife's documentation was destroyed in mid-1939, Rife did all he could to provide Crane with as much information regarding the design and construction of the frequency instruments that he could remember, including the details of the frequencies that were used. Fortunately, Dr. Gruner of Canada, who had worked with Rife in the 1930s, had a circuit diagram of a Hoyland Rife Ray instrument and he sent Crane a copy. The frequency instruments that Crane, Rife and Marsh started to build used audio frequencies. It may have been that they were the easiest to build because they already had a working Beam Ray Corporation instrument to base their design on. Crane also lowered Hoyland's frequencies by a factor of 10. Marsh later said that they had come up with the frequencies using mathematics. Thompson knew what frequencies Hoyland's instrument used and he gave those frequencies to Rife, Crane and Marsh. There were a few variations in some of the new frequencies and these adjustments may have been necessary in order to get them to work better. Most people thought that the lower audio frequencies were Crane's invention. The facts have now shown that they were Hoyland's frequencies divided by 10. Crane said that the first instrument they built didn't work very well and it was not until 1957 that their instruments were giving the sort of results that had been achieved with the Hoyland instruments. The Palo Alto Detection Laboratory, the Kalbfeld Laboratory, the UCLA Medical Laboratory and the San Diego Testing Laboratory were each provided with a frequency instrument to test whether the output from the instrument was harmful or not. All four laboratories declared that the instrument was safe to use. In December 1953, with Crane's encouragement and with increasing confidence as he saw his work being revived, Rife wrote a report titled History of the Development of a Successful Treatment for Cancer and Other Virus, Bacteria and Fungi. The Rife Virus Microscope Institute, San Diego, published this report. In this report Rife described his methods and the results achieved with his cancer cure. However, the established medical authorities ignored the report. At the beginning of 1954, Rife copyrighted his cancer report. Also in 1954, Allied Industries applied for a research grant. Rife was listed as the principal investigator for the grant, and was shown as the director of research. John Crane was listed as the manager and design engineer, Bern Thompson as the chief electronics engineer, Don Tully as the development associate, and Cameron Bland as an electronics engineer. Dr. James Kusch, MD, was listed as a consultant to the company. By 1956, Allied Industries had changed its name to Life Labs Incorporated, with Crane as the president and Reif as the chief of research. The address of the company was shown as being at 4246 Pepper Drive, San Diego. On November 8, 1956, the San Diego section of the Instrument Society of America witnessed the first public showing of the new frequency instruments, along with one of Reif's microscopes. In July 1957, Crane supplied frequency instruments to Dr. Robert Stafford of Dayton, Ohio, who began to conduct clinical trials. Here is a quote from Marsh's papers. Reif, Marsh and Crane were talking at great length about Marsh's trip to Ohio to see Dr. Stafford. In the Gonin papers they talked about the frequencies. I would recommend that everyone read these papers because they show that Reif, Crane and Marsh worked as a team and that Marsh and Crane considered the Life Labs Incorporated instrument to be Reif's instrument. Reif, well, I have lived my life for the benefit of humanity, and it is the end result of the accomplishment. Marsh, yes, now here is what I did tell them. They wondered where I fit into the picture. I told them I had layouts of the base, that I designed part of it. You would say that I was possibly not exactly an inventor, but I think we are all co-inventors of a sort by adding what we think would make the instrument better, and if they try to validify and verify any of the statements that I have said to them, please don't let me down, and say no, this isn't so, which might upset what might be the truth to them. I mean just by accident. Now what I mean by that is this. I don't think that I have in my own right lead to them. I didn't try to impress them with the idea that I was the one that did it. I did impress that you Reif, John Crane and myself had worked together on this thing, but that you Reif were the inventor and John Crane was the designer and inventor, co-inventor and myself for putting this thing together and making it. They asked if I helped putting this thing together and making it from time to time. I couldn't tell them that I didn't, because if I had built up a feeling in them that I knew nothing about what I was doing, psychologically that could have torn down, or have caused delay to the foundation that now is laid. Now I think we have a solid footing there. I under no circumstances would want that torn down, and I will not under any circumstances accept the credit for this instrument as being invented, because it is Reif's instrument is printed on the plate in front, and that is one of the reasons in building you up to them, which I don't think is unwarranted. Not by a darn sight, and that is why they want you there. They want to hear you talk, and they also want to know your past experiences with the people of La Jolla, and also I was very happy to have received the paper concerning the drive, etc., because I'm sure Stafford will contact every blooming drive that you had given him to me, and I turned over all the letters to him, because I didn't want anything to stand in the way if he could contact him. Now whether he would do that, before he would talk to the group, and I do not know. I suppose he will, but he wants the truth as badly as you do. Now I don't know an easier way it can be done. I don't think there is going to be an easy way to get it on, but I think I've outlined this thing. I studied the moves I was going to make before I ever went there. I studied what I was going to do if I had the opportunity to do so, which I did. Reif, well, I think that you did a very excellent job. From the John Marsh Tape Collection, Trip to Ohio Papers, pages 4 and 5 on www.reif.org. In October 1957, Crane made a circuit change that allowed control of the intensity of the ray emission. In November 1957, after 6 months of testing, Dr. Stafford reported positive results. Of 4 patients with cancer, 1 made remarkable and unexpected improvement. The other 3 were treated while in a terminal stage. All 3 died, but all obtained relief once the treatment was initiated. Autopsies were done on 2 of them. The results showed they had died from other causes. Stafford reported that there was a surprising paucity of cancer cells. Stafford also noted that of 33 patients treated for a variety of ailments, none experienced any detrimental effects from the treatments. In January 1958, Crane supplied Reif Crane frequency instruments to a group of Salt Lake City doctors who began to use the instruments on patients. In February 1958, Dr. Stafford presented his findings to the Executive Committee of the General Practice Section of the Montgomery County Medical Society of the AMA. The committee of 8 doctors were impressed. They agreed to allow Dr. Stafford to set up a research committee with Dayton's most influential doctors. In March 1958, Dr. Jepson at Salt Lake City, Utah reported that the trials with the Rife Crane instruments were successful. However, by May the Salt Lake County Medical Board forced Jepson to stop providing Rife treatments. In May and June 1958, Crane received reports that the Rife Crane instruments often strayed off the desired set frequency, which hindered the success of the treatments. Stafford used the AZ-58 for 5 years on his patients. His report is very favorable on many conditions that he used it for, but when it came to cancer treatment, it seems that the AZ-58 instrument did not work as well as Hoyland's instrument did. Stafford said this about the AZ-58 frequency instrument: "As yet, we have failed to cure any case of advanced, terminal malignancy. It appears in several instances that we may have impressed the disease favorably, temporarily. It is difficult to rule out the psychological, morale booster effect to the terminal patient when some definitive effort is made again in his behalf. However, several improvements have appeared to be more physical than emotional. All the patients in the series were treated with the same frequencies, for example, 728, 784, 880, 2008-2128. Perhaps these frequencies may be wrong, or only nearly correct." From the John Marsh tape collection, Dr. Stafford's report on using the AZ-58 on www.rife.org. "Everyone that has been involved with Rife technology for a long time has seen the very same results as Stafford. The question is, why did Hoyland's audio instrument work so much better than the AZ-58 when it came to cancer? It appears that Life Labs Incorporated should have built the AZ-58 exactly the same as Hoyland's machine and not changed it as they did. The instrument had to be built exactly the way Hoyland built it for it to work properly. This unique way of building the instrument appears to have accomplished what he wanted to do, and that was to keep anyone from finding out what the true MORs were." As we have already read, Stafford came to suspect that the audio frequencies were not the true MORs, and he corresponded with Dr. Edward Jepson in Salt Lake City regarding this problem. Here is an extract from his letter. "Please excuse my format in the following letter, for I intend to ramble a bit and forget strict grammatical dictum. I am writing you at this time partially because John Marsh informs me in a recent letter that you may be somewhat disheartened or at least worried about your role in the experimentations with the Rife machine. Believe me, Dr. Edward, I know how you feel, for I too have been through this same feeling with this matter. I have observed clinical results after treatments with this gadget which I can scarcely believe myself. Yet, despite these good results, I have been confused by some rather simple failures, such as a recent experiment which I conducted at Good Samaritan Hospital, where we used the machine to treat some cultures of Staph aureus and Strept fecalis. In this work we failed to inhibit growth at all or influence the cultures with the Rife RX. I sent the results to John Marsh and asked for clarification, and to be very frank, I am not satisfied with John's excuse of the failure as described by Dr. Rife. I am afraid I'm not a very good apostle, for I'm getting some ideas myself on how this thing may work. I really wonder if this ultrasonic kills bacteria and virus at all, or does it work like other forms of ultrasonic and merely stimulate the tissue in some unusual manner, thereby improving the circulation and secondarily enhancing the body's defenses against infection." Oh, summarize some of this rambling. I feel that the Rife ultrasonic therapy has a very definitely beneficial effect on the human and canine body. I furthermore feel that we, as doctors of medicine, using this machine must remain constantly alert to the condition of our patient and vary the RX as indicated. Let me hear from you, Dr. Jepson. How are your cases coming along?" Clearly Dr. Stafford didn't believe that the audio frequencies were correct. Little did he know they weren't even close to the true frequencies. The Rife Ray No. 4 frequencies were the correct ones, and the AZ-58 could not output these frequencies. It could only try and reach these frequencies by harmonics. Whatever was told to Dr. Stafford by Dr. Rife through John Marsh, there was no way that they were going to tell Dr. Stafford he wasn't choosing the correct frequencies. This would ruin everything that they had worked for. Besides, they were testing the AZ-58 to see how well it would work using audio frequencies. At this time, it is apparent the AZ-58 was not performing as well as Hoyland's instrument. We need to remember Hoyland tested his instrument using Dr. Rife's microscope. When Henry Sinner was in England testing Hoyland's instrument, he reported that it would kill the organisms while they were looking at them under Rife's microscope. Dr. Stafford found out the AZ-58 was not capable of doing this. In the 1950s, Rife no longer had a lab for testing any microorganisms. They were not able to test the AZ-58 frequencies properly with a microscope. So they did the only thing they could. They let the doctors use it and tell them how well it worked. We must remember the first instrument that Rife gave to Marsh and Crane was Hoyland's, and it worked. Marsh said it cured his wife of cancer. Again, the fact is the AZ-58 never worked as well as Hoyland's instrument. How Hoyland came up with his idea to build his instrument and make it work is still not fully understood. The changes made to Hoyland's instrument to produce the AZ-58 were not good changes. These changes did not produce the same results as Hoyland's instrument. But still, even with the changes, the AZ-58 worked very well on just about everything else but cancer. These lower square wave audio frequencies are what people have been using for the past 50 years, believing they were Rife's true MORs. Until the Beam Ray Corporation trial papers, John Marsh papers, and the Beam Ray Corporation instrument of Hoyland's came to light, we did not have the ability to finally figure out where all these frequencies came from, or which frequencies were the true MORs. Notwithstanding the various setbacks, Dr. Stafford was still amazed at the wonderful results he achieved with the AZ-58. In June 1958, Crane built the first contact pad frequency instrument, and by August 1958, Stafford had the big machine with the blue light bulb and the new little machine with the direct applicators. The development of the contact pad or electrode-type instrument was done supposedly with Rife's assistance. Crane had reasoned that the radio transmitter type plasma ray tube instruments would have difficulty getting licensed as health devices, and thought that a machine using contact pads, instead of a ray tube, would achieve the same results and be more acceptable to the medical authorities. Rife apparently supported this development, since Crane and Rife are heard in Marsh's recordings, talking about these instruments. Crane had reasoned that the essence of the instrument was the use of the correct frequency, and any means to deliver the frequency would be acceptable if it was effective. Rife stated later that he had observed a test of the effect of the electronic frequency generator, of the type produced by John Crane, and that he had seen the instrument kill earthworms, Bacillus coli, and other microbes. Initially, Crane just used a HealthKit audio frequency generator, although later on he found that a more refined, purpose-built instrument worked better. At the end of 1958, the California Public Health Department held a hearing regarding the use of the Rife-Crane frequency instrument. Despite having been declared safe by four prominent laboratories, the AMA board under the California Director of Public Health, Dr. Malcolm Merrill, declared it unsafe and banned it from the market. In 1959, Dr. Koch provided Crane with a taped interview and testimonial titled 22 Years of Applied Medical Therapy with the Rife Frequency Instrument. On February 28, 1959, Dr. Stafford initiated discussions with Crane for the rights to manufacture and distribute the frequency instruments in the eastern United States. He had already discussed a partnership with Harold Leland, who was an electrical engineer, and they intended to form a company to manufacture the frequency instruments, under license from Life Labs Incorporated. Crane replied to Stafford in March 1959, and he discussed the details of how the business venture between them could be structured. Crane also indicated that he was looking forward to completing the design of the first production instruments. He made a point that these would operate below 10 kHz to avoid any licensing requirements by the FCC. Obviously, the machines that they had been working with up until that time were considered to be experimental machines, and a final design was still being devised. Crane also proposed a plan to only lease and not sell the new instruments so that there would be more control over the instruments to ensure that they were periodically checked for effectiveness. Crane was concerned that, if the instruments did not work correctly, the doctors would fail to get good results in occurrence that had troubled them in the past. Crane had already completed a preliminary patent application with a California attorney, and he sent a copy of it to Dr. Stafford for his Ohio patent attorney to examine. The two patent attorneys were in agreement that the application was in order. However, during the period 1959 to 1960, Crane was unable to submit the patent application to the government patent office until the usefulness of the invention could be shown. He was advised that substantial evidence had to be gathered from enough doctors and others experimenting with the different frequencies before the patent application would be accepted. With no organized medical, scientific and laboratory involvement in the research, as had been the case in the 1930s, Crane was forced to establish usefulness under a very difficult handicap. There was opposition from the California Public Health Department, and he already had problems with the authorities in Salt Lake City. So Crane decided to lease the frequency instrument out to doctors in order to build his experimental base and thus prove the usefulness of the device. The number of people who were being healed with the machines began to mount. Crane slowly gathered reports, testimonials, and evidence. In the meantime, he refined the procedures for the operation and use of the pad-type frequency instrument. In 1960, Crane wrote and copyrighted a manual explaining how the frequency instrument was to be used. By the time, about 90 instruments were in use by doctors for research and verification purposes. Crane finally improved the efficiency of the instrument by placing a tuning capacitor in the resonant circuit of high voltage transmission. However, things were soon to turn against Crane and his colleagues. Towards the end of 1960, the AMA and the FDA raided Crane's office and $20,000 worth of equipment, electronic parts, engineering data, research records and reports were removed, along with all his pictures off the wall, private letters, invoices and tape recordings. This was reputedly done without a search warrant. Doctors who had Rife Crane instruments were visited and forced to give them up. Ordinary citizens who had begun to experiment personally were threatened. Eventually, the partners of Life Labs Incorporated were served with a summons regarding the manufacture and sale of illegal medical devices and practicing medicine without a license. Rife, then almost 73, was unable to handle more abuse from the authorities and went into hiding in Mexico. On March 7, 1961, while in Mexico, Rife provided a sworn deposition to assist with Crane's defense. In spring 1961, the case of the people of the state of California versus John Marsh, Lalas Battison, and John Crane came to trial. From the beginning, the case went badly against the defendants. Crane, Battison and Marsh were not allowed to use any of the records and materials seized in their own defense. The judge did not permit Rife's deposition or Dr. Stafford's reports or any other medical reports from the 1930s and 1940s to be presented as evidence. Dr. Tully provided Crane with a testimonial document titled A Discussion on the Frequency Instrument Therapy, but it was also not permitted to be presented. The foreman of the jury was an AMA doctor, and the balance of the jury was screened to make sure that they had no medical or electronic knowledge. No frequency instruments were presented or demonstrated in court. The only medical opinion offered by the state of California came from Dr. Paul Shea, who had been asked to evaluate a frequency instrument by the public health department 2 months before the trial. Shea admitted that he never tried it or made tests to evaluate it. He simply examined it and decided that it had no curative powers and didn't lend itself to investigative use. Ben Cullen related an interesting occurrence during the trial. Byrne Thompson was called to testify, and the prosecution asked him some questions about Crane's device. They asked, "Was it any good?" And Thompson said, "No, it was not any good, it was just a fake." When Thompson came off the witness stand, Cullen beckoned him over and said to him, "For goodness sakes, now you knew the value of those little black boxes. They were properly calibrated for certain conditions. Why did you lie that way?" Thompson replied, "I have a job to protect." And Cullen said, "For goodness sakes alive, You mean to say you would lie and send a man over the road to protect your job? Thompson said, I have a family. The trial lasted 24 days and Crane and Marsh were both found guilty and were sentenced to 10 years in prison. Later on appeal to the state Supreme Court, two of the three counts against Crane were reversed because no specific criminal intent had been proven. After the trial, Stafford was so pressurized by the authorities that he gave up medicine. Using his time in prison constructively, Crane studied law and was successful in obtaining an early release for both himself and Marsh. Crane and Marsh spent a total of 3 years and 1 month in jail. When Crane was released from prison in 1964 on parole, he was watched closely by the San Diego police. On at least one occasion, after attending a meeting of the early San Diego Cancer Control Society, he was arrested by the police and taken to jail for violating his parole conditions by attending such a meeting. Although the Rife cancer cure was in a shambles, Crane vowed to begin the fight all over again. After their release from prison in 1964, Crane and Marsh continued to collaborate together on their Rife work, but they were forced to work separately so as not to violate the terms of their parole conditions. During December 1964, Crane met Ron G. Rockwell, who began to work with Crane building Rife frequency instruments. In October 1965, Crane submitted an application to the California Board of Public Health for approval of the frequency instrument. The application was made in the name of the Rife Virus Microscope Institute, of which John Crane was stated to be the president. Sometime in late 1965, Rife returned from Mexico but remained in the background. On 17 November, the California Board of Public Health replied that Crane must first show the instrument to be effective in use before they will grant any approvals. Dr. Charles W. Bunner, a chiropractor, agreed to provide proof of effectiveness. Shortly thereafter, officials from the California Board of Public Health visited Bunner and forbade him to use the instrument. They also presented him with a court order to have the instrument destroyed. Dr. Les Strown, another chiropractor, provided Crane with a statement regarding the effectiveness of the instrument. Drown was then forced by an American Cancer Society representative to surrender his frequency instrument or go to jail. On March 4, 1968, for the sum of $500, Rife signed over ownership of the rights of invention of his microscope to Crane. It was stated in the assignment of invention that Crane intended to patent the Rife microscope and that Rife would give all assistance for Crane to obtain the patent. Rife already had considered the frequency instrument to be jointly owned by himself and Crane because of all the work that Crane had done on it. During 1970, Crane continued to seek funding for research and applied to the National Cancer Institute, the Rockefeller Foundation and others for financial aid and support. On October 10, 1972, Rockwell was officially appointed as the chief engineer and machinist for the Rife Virus Microscope Institute. In 1973, Crane again tried to patent the frequency instrument. Here are some extracts from the patent application. It has been well known by Rife, myself and others that a specific cancer virus causes the cancer which was long ago isolated by Royal R. Rife and cancer was cured by Rife in animals and in clinical tests with people and was published by the Smithsonian Report for 1944 on pages 193-220 as written by R. E. Seidel, M.D. and C.U.S. Government Printing Office Publication Number 3781 which has five plates of Rife's microscopes. It was observed that electromagnetic energy utilizing a frequency of 2127 cycles per second modulated on a carrier wave of 4150 kilocycles 4.15 mHz at 200 watts was lethal to cancer. Such virus as cancer and other viruses such as tuberculosis, typhoid, polio and many others are a threat to health in water. A great many other viruses have been destroyed by subjecting them to transmitted electromagnetic energy of frequencies, which are resonant or harmonic with such virus. The precise frequency required for their demise and control is set forth in the following table, tetanus 120 cps cycles per second or hertz, treponema 660 cps, gonorrhea 712 cps, typhoid 712 cps, staphylococci 728 cps, pneumonia 776 cps. Streptothrix 784 cps, Bacillus coli rot 800 cps, tuberculosis rot 803 cps, streptococci 880 cps, tuberculosis virus 1552 cps, sarcoma virus 2008 cps, carcinoma virus 2127 cps. Fig 32 is an electronic diagram of the direct contact frequency instrument used to devitalize virus, bacteria, worms, and fungi in the animal and human body. 1. Square wave range equals 60 to 30 kHz. 2. Output voltage at 10 kΩ and higher equal 14 volts. 3. Rated output power equal 100 milliwatts into rated load 10 volts across a 1000 ohm resistive load. The circuit is described as an audio square wave generator. It consists of a vacuum tube oscillator of the resistance capacitance type. It consists of a two-tube oscillator that oscillates at the resonant frequency of the Weinbridge frequency determining network inserted in the feedback path. The oscillator is coupled to a cathode follower amplifier that acts as an isolation stage and as a power amplifier. The square wave is formed by a dual clipping circuit that is inserted between the oscillator and the cathode follower stage for square wave stage output. The tube-type audio square wave oscillator can be replaced by a transistor-type circuit. Figure 33 is an electronic diagram of the Ray tube frequency instrument, which consists of a Hartley oscillator modulated with a square wave generator. The RF energy level is in excess of 8000 volts and the Ray tube is generally filled to 15 millimeters of helium gas after thorough evacuation, providing a brilliant pink discharge glow when activated as an antenna to transmit audio frequencies. The unit has been supplemented with a frequency counter to monitor the critical resonant frequencies induced from the variable oscillator. The specifications are for my experimental model No. AZ58. 1. Audio range equal 50 to 6000 Hz. 2. Modulated carrier range equal 4680 kHz. 3. Distortion equal less than 0.6%. 4. Input power requirements equal 350 watts, 105 to 125 volts, 50 to 60 cycles per second AC. 5. Output voltage equal 7000 to 15000 volts to the Ray tube. 6. Audio frequency calibration. 7. Treatment time is normally 3 minutes for each calibrated dial setting. A 3-day interval is suggested to recover from its overload caused by the cosmic devitalizations. In 1978, Crane published a report titled Electron Therapy Research. In October 1979, Ronald G. Rockwell was appointed as the chief engineer of the John F. Crane Corporation, which was now the name of Crane's company. The address of the company was still shown to be the same address that was used by Life Labs Incorporated and the Rife Virus Microscope Institute. At about the same time, John Marsh ended his association with Crane. Marsh and Crane had always had strained relationship, mainly because Marsh felt that Crane never gave him sufficient credit for the work that he had done on the Rife instruments. Marsh had concentrated on the Ray tube instruments because he thought that they worked better, while Crane devoted all of his energies to the contact pad devices. Before he died in 1987, Marsh entrusted his collection of documents, photos, audio tapes and films to the nurse who was taking care of him. After Marsh's death, the nurse passed Marsh's Rife collection to Jeff Garf. In 1984, John Bedini and Dr. Robert Strecker, who had both developed an interest in Rife's work, visited John Crane at his home. Bedini, who is an audio engineer, scientific researcher and inventor, had expertise in the field of audio power amplifiers, 3D sound processors, nonlinear pulse energy circuits, and AM/FM transmitters and wished to find out how the Rife frequency devices worked. Strecker, a gastroenterologist with a PhD in pharmacology, was particularly interested in wanting to get the Rife microscope to work and would culture bacteria and different viruses to assist Bedini in his research to see if Rife technology worked. Initially, Crane was offered money for all the documents and Rife equipment that he had. Crane was eager to accept the money, since he had many debts, but he refused to sell any of the original Rife equipment. Therefore, Bedini and Strecker proposed that Crane should come and work for them and that in exchange Crane would be looked after and all of his debts would be paid. Crane agreed to this arrangement and allowed Bedini and Strecker full access to all of the Rife documents and equipment. Crane had the Rife No. 3 microscope, an AZ-58 machine and many other bits and pieces that Rife had passed on to him. Both men found that it was difficult to work with Crane, especially since Crane would often appear to be secretive and vague, and he often did things without their knowledge and consent. The working relationship was strained and full of mistrust, while Bedini and Strecker tried to convert Crane's theoretical Rife knowledge into practical results. Although they found Crane to be very knowledgeable about much of Rife's work, Bedini came to realize that Crane did not know or fully understand the exact design details and working principles of Rife's original frequency instruments. Crane had the AZ-58 and simple square wave generators, but during the early tests done with them, under Crane's guidance, none of those devices would destroy any microbes. After many hours of questioning and discussions with Crane, Bedini realized that the method of generation of the frequencies was far more complex than what was originally thought. Crane had built some very good microscopes and was an excellent engineering draftsman and machinist, but that was where his expertise ended. Bedini did not have much success with getting the Rife microscope to work due to a lack of knowledge of the details of its operation. The work was also hampered because many of the lenses and prisms were missing. Eventually, the work on the microscope ended when Barry Lyons and his associates obtained a court order to take the microscope away from Crane. It transpired that Crane had previously concluded the sale of the instrument to somebody, but had never given the instrument to its new owner. However, Bedini continued with his experiments with the Rife frequency instruments. The story was relayed by Bedini in a radio interview on Jeff Rentz's radio show in September 2006. In February 1986, Barry Lyons wrote an article titled, "How the Cure for Cancer Was Covered Up, Treatment Suppressed Since 1930s in a Washington, D.C. newspaper called The Planet." The newspaper was provided free to government officials and to students and professors of the George Washington University Medical School. Not one person was motivated to investigate further. Lyons was astounded by the total lack of response, and so he decided to write a book to expose the Rife story. Lyons tracked down John Crane and persuaded Crane to assist him with the book by providing all the information that Crane possessed about Rife's work. In April 1987, Lyons published his book titled The Rife Report, The Cancer Cure That Worked. 50 Years of Suppression. A short while after the book was published, a lengthy document titled The Crane Report was compiled that detailed much of Crane's involvement with the Rife instruments. It seems that Crane was disappointed that Lyons had not given Crane more exposure and credit in the book for the work that Crane had done on the Rife instruments. The document appears to have been written by someone with legal and patent experience, although Crane obviously must have provided all of the information. Later that same year, no doubt encouraged by the new interest shown in Rife's work, Crane again was preparing another patent application regarding the Rife technology. There are records that show that in 1988, Crane had established a treatment clinic in Mexico and was using contact pad electrode and radio frequency driven plasma lamp instruments to provide cancer treatment. On one video which Crane produced, a patient in a hospital in Mexico is seen with a plasma lamp machine, and is thanking Crane. She says that the machine had saved her life from cancer and had relieved her of pain. She had been told, at a major health facility in western Los Angeles, that she would be on chemotherapy for the rest of her life, but after having treatment from the Rife Crane machine, her tumors had healed, and she felt great. In 1989, Crane combined all of his notes and information into a single book that he titled Polarity Research Manual. On December 21, 1991, Crane granted to Rockwell, by a special power of attorney, all the rights of ownership of the AZ-58 frequency instrument together with all of his research and equipment. Rockwell formed a company called the Rife Research Laboratory in Las Vegas, Nevada, and he undertook to revive Rife's work in accordance with modern scientific methods. A few years later, Rockwell renamed his company as Rockwell Scientific Research LLC. For some reason, in 1992, Crane decided to file a class action against the U.S. authorities. In an affidavit dated June 7, 1992, Crane claimed that he was a private attorney with over 20 years of litigation experience. In addition, he stated that he had worked as an engineer in the aerospace industry and spent 14 years learning aerospace trades and juniman procedures. He also claimed to have graduated from the Sequoia Research Institute in September 1972 and stated that he had subsequently worked as a professor at the Sequoia University. In the same affidavit, Crane made some wild and exaggerated remarks regarding Rife's career from 1914 to 1939. Crane stated that Rife was trained by the U.S. Secret Service in Europe to catch saboteurs sick in Europe in optics by Karksixizsik Corporation and other chemical labs having been trained in the USA, Germany, Austria, Switzerland and Belgium in connection with said investigation and training. It is not known how far this legal attempt went, but it marked a sad and pathetic end to Crane's career. At least up until 1965, Crane must be given full credit for reviving much of Rife's work and trying to improve the frequency instrument. However, Crane was not a skilled electronics engineer and often produced confusing information regarding the Rife-type devices that his company produced, or was he smoke screening or purposely trying to mislead others so that the secrets of Rife would not be able to be copied? Despite Crane's assistance in providing much of the information that led to the publication of the Rife Report, the cancer cure that worked. 50 years of suppression written by Barry Lyons, in an additional chapter pages 135 to 136, added to the book in 1997, Lyons is very critical of Crane's handling of the Rife affair. This is an extract from Lyons' book. Crane collected and preserved the record of Rife's work and never quit when the going got tough, as many others did. But it is also important to acknowledge that Crane was in many ways inadequate to the task he assumed. He did not have the management or political skills, which Dr. Milbank Johnson had demonstrated, and was not able to bring aboard the qualified scientists, businessmen, financiers and attorneys who could have altered the course of medical history. Unfortunately, Crane managed to antagonize many of the professionals who offered help, and his efforts to legitimize the Rife instruments in the 1950s were not as professional as they might have been. Crane bore the brunt of the medical, political and legal opposition to the Rife legacy, and he became bitter. He wasted years filing ill-advised lawsuits against the state of California, Vice President Nelson Rockefeller and some 52 other persons and organizations. Acting as his own lawyer, Crane launched attacks that were a mishmash of accusations and citations in 1959, a year before the authorities struck. Crane was demanding $150 million from interested investors, an unusually high amount for the time. Interested investors apparently existed, but they evidently did not view Crane as a person to whom serious seed money should be advanced, no matter how brilliant or profitable Rife's scientific genius. Following Rife's death in 1971, Crane continued to attract interested investors, but no agreements were concluded. From 1984 to 1988, Rife's universal microscope passed through the hands of several groups and individuals who undertook to restore it, but no progress was made towards this goal. A federal legal action had to be initiated in order to have it returned, finally, to its legitimate owners Rife Labs, a company formed to revitalize Rife's work in accordance with modern scientific methods. A great deal of the failure to resurrect Rife's discoveries and inventions in a way that would bring them into mainstream acceptance and utilization for countless people can be attributed to Crane's greed, ego and obstructionism. He and a cohort of cronies, crooks and lowlifes who surrounded him during the period 1987-1995 tried to exploit Lyons' book for their own gain, in a way which did not serve the larger public interest, but utterly failed indeed, did not even attempt to corroborate Rife's findings. Crane died with a reputation for dishonest dealings. He had given the world a precious gift preserving Rife's accomplishment, but he apparently never comprehended his own greater obligations, and could never rise above his own narrow self-interest in order to accomplish objectives which clearly could have been attained through righteous dealings. After working with Crane in the mid-1980s, John Gaudini was also critical of Crane's honesty and motivation. Much of what Lyons had said about Crane was confirmed firsthand by Gaudini during his association with Crane. Crane died on June 5, 1995 following a minor illness in San Diego. The end. Thank you for listening.